triple talaq. I think it would be appropriate to recall Sir Sayyid's views on the subject. Remember, he lived in an era in which divorce was unknown to Hindu law. As to divorce, he first enumerated its benefits to the society and mentioned the difficulties of those Christian societies which did not allow divorce. At that time, even Christian law did not have divorce. Sir Sayyid pointed out, which ultimately forced Protestants to allow divorce, as regards Islamic concept of divorce, this is what Sir Sayyid said, and I quote, "Our Prophet neither underrated nor overvalued divorce. He constantly pointed out to his followers how opposed it was to the best interest of society. He was expatiated his disciplines to treat women with respect and kindness, and to bear patiently their violence and ill temper. And he always spoke of those who availed themselves of divorce in a severe and disparaging manner." Kehte hai na ke, sari jayaz cheezon mein sabse zyada napasand talaq hai. "Notwithstanding, however, Muhammad's rooted antipathy to divorce, he gave it the importance and consideration it justly claimed and merited. He allowed it under circumstances when it could not fail to prove a valuable boon. When it either entirely removed or at least greatly elevated the cares, troubles, and the embitterment of wedded life. And when, if not taken advantage of, society would suffer still more than it already did. In such cases, divorce is far from being a disadvantage to society. It is, on the contrary, a blessing and an efficient means of bettering the social condition. Therefore, why live this janm janmantar ka saath? If your life has become hell, part ways in dignity and in kindness and start afresh." A great champion against ignorance, Sir Sayyid advocated a system of education which laid equal emphasis on training of mind and morals of the peoples. He stood for liberty of conscience and freedom of expression. I need to talk of a little bit on freedom of religion. Sir Sayyid had inaugurated, in the words of Tara Chand, a revolution in Muslim thought. His endeavor was to reform Muslims individually and collectively. It's a different story. We have not paid much attention to this old man. Few people know that while Sir Sayyid was opposed tooth and nail by the many Muslims, the Hindu community extended all possible help to him, and that is the only difference between him and Raja Ram Mohan Roy. The Hindu community, after initial reluctance, accepted Raja Ram Mohan Roy, but Muslim community rejected Sir Sayyid. The difference between the two men lies in the response each received from his community. While the Hindus by and large welcomed Sir Sayyid Roy, Sir Sayyid had only few takers. Akbar Allahabadi ne bhi kaha, bhai Sayyid to kuch diwane hain, wo kahan kisi ki maane hain. The establishment of MAO College was opposed by the conservatives. As many as 5 fatwas declaring him kafir were issued. Strangely enough, these fatwas have not yet been withdrawn. I will just quote one fatwa from Makkah. "This man, Sir Sayyid, is erring and causes people to err. He is rather an agent of the devil and wants to mislead Muslims. It is a sin to support the college. May God damn the founder." And if this college has been founded, pata nahi tha unko ke ban gaya hai, nahi bana hai, Makkah mein tab tak SMS aur email nahi tha. "And if this college has been founded, it must be demolished and its founders and his supporters thrown out of fold of Islam," unquote, declared the Imam of Kaaba. Now let me now quickly talk of freedom of religion, as I said, and talk of secularism, and talk of my problem of secularism and uniform civil code. Very strangely, the debate on freedom of religion clause in the Constituent Assembly, this Article 25, concluded on 6th December 1948. And 44 years later, on 6th December 1992, Babri Mosque will be demolished. Same day. And there are people who have become ministers, there are some who are still ministers, who can be seen in video clipping celebrating and enjoying the death of Indian secularism, the demolition of Indian secularism. The concept of freedom of religion is a modern idea. It is both chronologically and normatively. It is the gift of modern state that is not necessarily itself formally secular, but operates in social setting of widespread secularization. Freedom of religion is an aspect of liberal ideology of individualism. And this is the time when country has been partitioned in the name of religion. Shirin is saying that the burden of reforms lies on the Muslim community. It is the time, you know, when Patel is saying that the only nationalist Muslim in India is Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru. This is the time. This is the time when in the Constituent Assembly debates, I am not talking of some statements made in some papers. Hindi papers, of course, were venoming a lot of poison. People were saying that Muslims need to prove their loyalty. How do they prove their loyalty? They need to shed blood of Pakistanis. If there is a war, they have to fight against Pakistanis. Unless they shed blood of Pakistanis, they are not loyal to India. At that point of time, I believe that the framers of Indian Constitution did a remarkable job. India would have become a theocracy. I have written in one of some articles that this is an opportunity lost forever. India cannot now become a Hindu Rashtra, because now secularism is the basic structure of the constitution, and even by a constitutional amendment you cannot undo secularism. The Indian society displays a manifest tendency towards an outlook that is predominantly religious. The effect that religion has had on the progress of Indian society is tremendous. The Indian Constituent Assembly was already at work under the shadow of the partition of the country on the basis of religion and the accompanying widespread communal rights and mass migrations. The country had seen the ugly face of religious identity, but it was not at all ready to turn its back on religion. The framers of the Constitution did not write word secular or secularism into it, despite the efforts of one member, K.T. Shah, proposed that we should add word secular. But there was no consensus. But at the same time, K.V. Kamath's suggestion to start the preamble of the Constitution in the name of God was also not accepted. In fact, it was voted and God lost in a vote in religious India. Now, thus, God lost in a vote in deeply religious India. Words apart, the spirit of constitution breathed the ideal of freedom of religion. Secularism became an ideal in religious India due to the communalism, as secularism was understood as an answer to communalism. To make secularism acceptable, freedom of religion was guaranteed. John Stuart Mill, in discussing the question of religious freedom in his famous essay on liberty, was concerned exclusively with the liberty of individuals. But then no discussion on freedom of conscience would be complete if social aspects of religion were not given due weight. We have therefore to consider not only the religion of the state, relation of the state with the religion, but also state's relation with the individual in matters of religion, and finally the relation of the state with religious group. The European ideal was that the state shall be religion neutral. Therefore, secularism as a European ideal is talking of relationship of state with religion. But in India, we need to talk of relationship of religion with individual. and relationship of the group, religious group, with the state, and a state has to guarantee both. In the case of uniform civil code, this is the tension. Most write-ups which you have read in the newspapers and most uninformed debates which you have seen on TV, people talking about Article 25 versus Article 44. Now, Article 25 is only talking of right of an individual to religious freedom. Article 26 talks of rights of groups, right of religious groups. Article 25 is subject to other fundamental rights, but Article 26 is not subject to other fundamental rights. Therefore, when it is a question of right of a group, it is not subject to right to equality, because Article 26 says in matters of religion, you will have an autonomy. Therefore, Article 25 is in fact subject to Article 26. An individual has restricted freedom, but a group has a greater freedom. When India became independent, it was obvious to most leaders of Indian National Congress that it had to become a secular state, because they considered this to be the only form of government